Hello and welcome to the NewsX Sunday Guardian Roundtable. Well, the Modi government is all set to finish 3 years in office, only they are of course calling it, hashtagging it rather, as 1,000 days. But whatever, now is a good time to take a look at the pulse of the government and see what they've delivered on their promises and where they haven't delivered. Joining me on the roundtable is Samvit Patra, national spokesperson for the BJP, Dilip Cherian, image guru and also commentator. We have Rama Lakshmi, senior editor at The Print, and Pawan Khera, national spokesperson for the Congress. Rama, I'll begin with you. You know, we've heard Modi, the campaigner, we saw candidate Modi, all that he promised. Has Modi, the Prime Minister, delivered?
Well, you know what they say about politicians, they always campaign in verse, but they're forced to govern in prose. And that's true for all politicians, not just Modi. If you look at what Modi promised as a campaigner, there is a set of tangibles and a set of intangibles. The tangibles were more industries, more jobs, women's safety. The intangible was Achhe Din. How do you evaluate the intangible? Looks like he has definitely delivered on intangibles.
He has a lot of papers there. He's ready to evaluate.
He's definitely delivered on the intangible. People feel that they've got something, a government that functions. There's a faith. It's a faith-based support to the government and to Modi's rule. So definitely he's delivered on that.
Okay, he's delivered on a perception at least, Pawan. Would you agree?
The so-called intangibles, as Rama rightly said, also depend on the tangibles. But if the tangibles are missing, this faith can't last long. Now, there is a dichotomy in the governance goals and the kind of politics being pursued. The kind of politics being pursued is defeating the governance goals. Look at what's happening. Saharanpur, Alwar, Dadri, Haryana. All this doesn't infuse investor confidence. Why would anybody invest in a region which is disturbed, which has a lot of social tensions? There's a huge law and order problem. So I don't know how far and how long will the intangible keep helping them. Without, of course, they have to deliver on tangibles, which I'm afraid has not been delivered.
Well, they're at least helping them win elections, isn't it? I think that's what Samvit would say. I let Pawan.
That's a tangible. That's one tangible, yeah.
Okay, one tangible has happened.
See, as it is said in Hindi, Mai Baap is the Janta. They are the ones who at the end of the day go through the Hisab Kitab of any government, and they are the ones who decide whether the government has given tangible benefits, the government is only high on rhetorics, or the government is one which is to be pushed out of the window. The recent elections, very humbly I would state, because since we are in governance in a huge portion of this country, so I believe I should be the most humble one over here in the table with sense of responsibility. I would say that the people of India only about few months ago reposed faith on Mr. Narendra Modi's governance module in Uttar Pradesh, in Goa, in Manipur, and the other states only shows that, well, yes, we are moving the right path. My friend, who's a very good spokesperson, let me compliment Mr. Pawan, and say that he was speaking about investment. How would investment come because there are Saharanpur, etc., etc. I have brought some newspaper Hisab Kitab of only 4 days, the previous last 4 days. This is of the Hindu. FDI inflows in India double to $46 billion. Check out the data. And the data is over here as to how in a short span of time.
My problem with statistics is it can be interpreted anywhere. He'll pull out some statistics. So let's just talk about the perception.
I believe our Prime Minister has always taught us on Hisab Kitab. He speaks that jab main aaunga to main Hisab Kitab dunga. So I have to speak on statistics as well as I have to answer the questions thrown by them. I'll just begin by saying what the tangible and Achhe Din is. Look, I as a young person feel, why was it that after 70 years of India's independence, 60% of India's populace was out of formal banking system? And no one ever thought of this. No one thought that this was a big deal. They thought, well, hota hai, chalta hai. Here is a Prime Minister who formed the government in 2014. His first priority was, how is it that 60% of Indian population is outside of the formal banking system? Then they have a different loan structure. They have atrocities against them. So why not include them and why not have an inclusive policy? The first priority was, well, let's get the Jan Dhan Yojana. Let everyone have the bank account. The benefit, the direct benefit transfer, 66,000 crore was saved in 1 year. Secondly, Mr. Modi has always spoken about one thing very important. He says that I don't want growth in small measures. Thoda hai, thode ki zarurat hai is not what I believe in. I believe in incremental. I don't believe in incremental movements. I believe in quantum jumps. I'll just show you one such thing in which it has been a quantum jump, the LPG Yojana. In this LPG Yojana, you would see that while the previous government, in fact, this is the data, See, this government has all the data in record.
But you have all the records.
No, no, and this is truth. I'll tell you what, we did not win elections in air. I'll tell you, this LPG, Ujjwala Yojana, look, the 10 years when Mr. Manmohan Singh was in governance, when he came into governance in 2004, the jump was from 7.71 crore to 13.02 crore, the LPG. That means in 10 years, 5.31 crore LPG was added. Only in 2.5 years, 6.7 crore LPGs were added. This is called as a quantum jump in governance, and this is what has gained us the foothold. You know, 49 lakh families getting this chulhas in their home in Uttar Pradesh, 19 lakh in Delhi. Okay. It's not that we won the election in air, we won the election on ground.
Okay. Yeah, there is a huge gap in the data. It's just 16 million. There is a fact check required on their data. I agree, data can be twisted, but it can also be absolutely wrong. Gas connections, just 16 million. We have official data.
Okay, he's countering. But let me get...
It has the Prime Minister. I would not counter him. I will be very humble to say that this is the Prime Minister's office which releases this data, and I would believe that the Prime Minister's office would not release a fudged data.
Okay. I'll send you the data also.
All right, we'll get Pavan's data also. But Dilip, you know, this data war will go on. I mean, Samvit did make a point, LPG connections did play a role in winning the UP elections. But beyond that, you know, as of today, when we are discussing, we are seeing layoffs in tech companies in the south. Has the Prime Minister delivered on jobs, on employment?
You know, to be straight here, first is that let's look at the idea of the 1,000-day performance.
Okay.
It's a great idea because both in business school and in our communications business, we always say that proof of a concept is 1,000 days. So having a hashtag 1,000 days, smart. And that tells you how the government functions, because they know the cornerstone of smart governance is smart communications. So whether it's Samvit trotting out the Prime Minister's picture and the data, or whether it's Pawan saying that there is a fact check required, the perception that's created is UP was won, here are the figures, this proves our figures were right, okay, in some senses. Leave aside all this polarization and things. So this is a government which has understood the fundamental building block of all political success is communications.
Correct.
Communicating what they are doing and communicating that repeatedly from the mouths of many, led by the one. So that's a structure which works. In fact, good communications must always be led by the top. And Pawan knows that, and Pawan will probably agree, that you get hobbled if you have a leader who decides to be silent. He may perform, but silence is resounding. So the public wants to hear noises because that gives them a sense of comfort. Is it real? Will it deliver jobs? The answer is no. It hasn't delivered jobs, but it needs to deliver jobs. And I think that Prime Minister Modi is hugely conscious of this. So there is no lack of trying. Maybe there are jobs happening in the lowest segment, in the infrastructure segment, where a lot of current investment is going in, but there is need for anxiety because the numbers are still hugely lagging behind what the UPA did versus what the NDA has done in 3 years. If you compare like to like over 3 years, the statistics on that probably deserve also equal airing. So you need to figure out that is probably, along with social security, a sense of social security, the greatest need going forward, and what government needs to show delivery on in 1,000 days.
Okay. At least, Rama, the perception, I think we all agree, he has shown a perception of delivering. We've talked about the investment climate. What about internal security? That is where the perception kind of lags behind. You know, we've seen, despite this, that demonetization would solve, at least reduce the violence in Kashmir, has not happened.
Demonetization, reducing the violence in Kashmir was a WhatsApp message that went viral that many politicians aired. I don't think we should take it seriously, and I don't think people who are really intelligent took it seriously. It was winter. Stone pelting did come down during the winter. It has nothing to do with that. The other thing is perception. Yes, in perception, he has gained. In internal security, he has failed, I think, even in the perception. I remember in 2014, covering the campaign, many RSS leaders were going door to door, and one message they said to every resident, it was, Modi ji ko aane dijiye, no jawan will be beheaded at the border. That has not happened. The casualties on the borders have increased. Red corridor continues to burn. Kashmir continues to burn. The perception, as far as internal security is concerned, has failed.
Should I get Pawan and then, because you'll have to counter both of them, I think. Yes.
Okay, no issues.
No issues, Pawan.
I agree with Dilip as far as the communication part is concerned. But communicating what has been done is one part. Communicating what has not been done is what this government is very good at. Kashmir, she brought up the issue of Kashmir. Now, Kashmir is burning is a very mild way of putting it. Kashmir is a disaster. Pakistan, foreign policy, I don't know if you have a separate segment, but Pakistan, China, Nepal, Bangladesh. Nepal, our Prime Minister claims he informed them of the earthquake. Imagine, I mean, the earthquake was being informed by our Prime Minister to their Prime Minister. Within a few months, they come up with a constitution against Madhesis. Tight slap on our face. Bangladesh, poor Sheikh Hasina. She's a good friend in this region. What do you do to her? She comes asking for water, you offer her bijli.
But that is Mamata Banerjee, not the Prime Minister.
It's the Prime Minister's job to take everybody along. I'm sorry. The responsibility is of the Prime Minister. Look at China. They are renaming six of our districts in Arunachal Pradesh. This has never happened before. Pakistan is a sad saga of the failure of this government. Flip-flop, flip-flop. No idea what's happening. No coherence in your policy. No results of whatever you've done or not done. You bring ISI into Pathankot. You go celebrating birthdays. Fair enough, that could have been a maybe an attempt to sort of be friends with him. Fair enough, we'll grant him that. What happens? You refuse to talk to Pakistan because High Commissioner has called the Hurriyat leaders.
Okay, we get the drift.
But then the Prime Minister goes there. So no, where is the coherence?
Not many
but where
answers.
Is the coherence? And also, I don't know whether we can give the UP a clean chit, you know, the Kashmir problem.
The topic here is 3 years of Modi.
No, but
please tell me the topic is comparing UP with them, then I'll come up with
no, but
that.
We
also.
Have to also look at what he's inherited and what
definitely,
he's dealing with.
Definitely.
You know, we can take him
the number of Jawans dead.
I'll leave somewhere to tell
let's the come with the. I'm ready with the UP data also.
Yeah, let me. Let's not have data on Jawans dead. That would not sound really good.
No, I'm talking about the disturbances.
I understand because.
Incursions.
So dead bodies.
No,
fact,
no,
we are
number of incursions.
Create a positive environment.
No, I'm talking about number of incursions.
That's it. Okay, well, we'll do that. But you have asked a question, let me answer. First, let me begin by Dilip when he spoke about.
You're going all the way back to Dilip.
I have to because that's how it should be answered. First, he spoke about employment. I have tangible data with me over here. And that too from the SBI research, the largest bank of India. This is 4th March 2007, Hindu newspaper yet again, Sanjay Datta. And he writes that SBI during this period, India during this period, meaning August 2016 to February 2017, during this period, India's unemployment rate nearby halved to 4.8% in February, from 9.5% in August 2016. And the major reason as to what led to this decline in unemployment is, they say, Narendra Modi government's effort to generate employment opportunities in rural India, and most importantly, MNREGA, to which 48,000 crore rupees has been allotted. They go into the details as to how there has been a 166% increase in Anganwadi, 158 in drought proofing, rural drinking water, 698% increase, water conservation and harvesting, 142 increase.
Granting you so,
the employment has
data,
increased.
Sorry, we are not granting.
We are not granting
no,
the data.
Sorry,
you ask me questions,
yeah,
I have
no,
to
I'm
answer.
Sorry, let him answer. Tell her that I have a strong objection to the data.
Actually, the opposition will never grant me a pass.
No, you are a good spokesman.
A
I'm granting you that.
But secondly, as far as the internal security issue of the country is concerned, look, Pawan brought forth the issue of foreign policy. I'll tell you, even our dreadest enemies, I would not call them enemies, our opposition leaders, they also agree to the fact that the best part of Modi government has been the foreign policy.
I mean, who in the opposition agrees?
No, everyone.
Let me go and speak
See,
to
I have
them
seen
then.
Our most our vociferous critics agreeing to the fact that we have done really well on the foreign front.
Not one.
As far as saving our Indians across are concerned. Look at Yemen. In fact, all the countries asked for India to help.
There are 39 Indians still missing.
We should not be fighting. We should not be fighting.
I'll give you a turn. I'll give you a turn. He gave you a turn.
This is a very different kind of show where we have to be very sober and very toned down.
This is a news.
Yes.
We are also, we're just having fresh lines.
Yes, it's okay. So I believe that on the foreign front, we have done really well.
Okay.
In the Kashmir front, look, as you rightly pointed out, it's a legacy issue. The problem that the opposition has been consistently pointing and they have a criticism to make is that it is all because BJP formed a government in alliance with PDP and that's the reason as to why this unholy nexus, what they call, is responsible for this fallout. No. It's not that BJP and PDP were the ones responsible for the Kashmir problem. The Kashmir problem existed well before that. There were certain red lines that this government drew that we will not talk to the separatists, despite the fact that the previous dispensation wanted that we should be talking to the separatists. No, because those who are not shareholders do not believe in the constitution of the country should not be the ones whom we should talk to. Secondly, and very importantly, the two important things which I believe this government is marked out for is the surgical strike. And secondly, we were just discussing Kulbhushan Jadhav yesterday.
Correct.
After 46 years, India has a tactical shift, and the international arena only on 15th of this month, Monday, only about day after tomorrow. In fact, the world would be observing when the hearing would be starting. Harish Salve leading the hearing from India's side. So naturally, a tactical shift and a huge relief. I do not want to chest thump and I do not want to celebrate because the battle has been won. The war is still left to be won.
Right.
But I still believe this is if we compare Sharabjit with Kulbhushan Jadhav, I believe in a short span of time, the swiftness with which this government has moved is impeccable. I mean, within a short window of 60 days, the way the government convinced, remember, the quora of the International Court of Justice was not complete. But still, India could register its protest. India could convince the registrar of the International Court of Justice that, for God's sake, if this man is executed, then we would be deprived of our justice. And then the president issues a notice to Pakistan.
Okay.
This is a big and swift jump.
Okay. Dilip, last word for you on this internal security debate.
You know, I think the internal security debate is extremely complex because the moment you mix what Rama referred to, the Red Corridor, with Kashmir, then you're really talking about a pain point for India, which has now become, unfortunately, also an international issue. In the sense that internationally, it is being seen as something of concern. The fact is that the figures that Sambit threw just now of FDI,
SDI.
Oh no, I'm talking about the FDI, shows that the world is willing to give a chance because the fact is that the Indian market is showing signs of some progress and is asking for investment. You know, we haven't discussed this, but between Jandan, Aadhaar and mobile, what the BJP I'm sure would like to call jam, the jam is certainly being made visible to everybody, and this is a huge pie which is of attraction to global companies. So global companies are definitely still looking at India. There is this red flag up there about what happens if there is strife internally. So if I were the Prime Minister today, looking at my 1,000 days, I would say that's something I need to pay more attention to, not less. The globe and the globe's attractiveness to India still remains quite high. And the Hague move is, I think, a smart move from a global perspective.
But will it produce results?
But it's a smart move.
Pakistan listen to ICJ?
But at least there are so they've many done something, you know, something tangible, as
perception.
We talked about.
Perception, but it's a good move.
It's a smart move, as long as it doesn't result in internationalizing Pakistan.
That's a risk.
Clarification needed over here. Look, in this Hague move, we have to look at where the diversity exists, how it cannot internationalize Pakistan, Kashmir, in the sense that, number one, this is on the Vienna Convention. This is not on
Commonwealth.
It is not on the IJC, because in the International Court of Justice, which we were signatories, Pakistan and India in 1960, we had a caveat, and the caveat was we cannot sue each other. But the Vienna Convention, to which we were signatories, on 24th of April 1964, there is no such caveat. Over here, it is compulsory that we have to have consular access, and this is the clause that India has used to go to the
So they found a loophole and they have used it for us. We're going to take a quick break, but we're going to come back and also talk about the art of communication, of at least the way this government is communicating with the rest of the country. So stay with us. Welcome back to the NewsX Sunday Guardian Roundtable. We are here discussing 3 years of Prime Minister Modi's government, and we've been discussing his achievements, but also, Rama, if I can bring you in, the way he's been communicating, you know, we've been talking about, has it been a one-way communication? There is a feeling that he doesn't even need the media. You know, he has his Mann Ki Baat, he talks directly to the people, he holds his rallies, he talks directly to them. So,
media has traditionally in the last one and a half decades has had a hostile relationship with Mr. Modi. Right from the time when he was Gujarat chief minister.
Correct.
So what does he do when he comes to Delhi? He circumvents the traditional media. He goes for the ungated media community, which means not gated by traditional journalists. So direct Mann Ki Baat, his speeches are media communications, Twitter, social media, his use of social media, especially WhatsApp. None of these are gated by traditional journalists. Point number two, media usually in its evaluation of Modi government conflates two things. One is you evaluate the government. The other is you evaluate the climate, the mahal, the mahal of bigotry or intolerance or the debate that's getting more and more poisoned. That's different from assessing the Modi government. Media usually blames Modi for that as well. Is it right in doing so? Yes and no. The 2014 victory has emboldened certain narratives, certain forces, so people tend to blame Modi for that. Maybe that narrative already existed, but now they feel that they are legitimately voice those narratives. The other thing is, a lot of things, Saharanpur and other things that are happening around the country. Dadri, for instance, was in UP. UP was a law and order issue, state issue, but Modi was blamed for it. So media also tries to bring the two together. In assessing the government, are we also looking at the climate of social strife, as Dilip called it, and blaming Modi for it? Modi, the election campaigner, and Modi, the prime minister, very different. Modi, as prime minister, is flawless in his speeches, in his Twitter communication. He doesn't talk about Kabristan and Smashan as a prime minister. But when he's on an election campaign, he's a very different man. So we need to make those distinctions. We're somewhere losing the lines in our criticism of the government.
But the masses aren't, you know, they are voting for Modi the campaigner and Modi the prime minister. So he's getting what he wants at the end of the day.
No, as a campaigner, what Modi has done in this country, 3 years, the country is an extremely angry, aggressive country, sharply divided on very petty issues. I'm sorry, that blame goes on the doorstep of whether you want to call him a campaigner, whether you want to call him a prime minister. We don't see the prime minister as much as we see the campaigner in Mr. Modi.
All right.
It's absolutely undergoverned. Over-administered country now under Modi. So I don't know who to blame, the campaigner Modi or the Prime Minister Modi. The campaigner for speaking out things which he should not speak out, or the Prime Minister Modi for keeping quiet where he should not keep quiet. When it came to Dadri, they said it was a state government issue, law and order. Now Saharanpur, whose state government is it? Haryana, whose state government was it? Alwar, whose state government was it? Who do we blame, the campaigner or the Prime Minister?
Who do we blame?
See, the blame lies with the opposition itself because of lack. Because of a lack of a persistent campaigner as Mr. Modi in their fold.
I agree.
What That's they try point. To do is they try to find fault with a super campaigner. Look, I'm a young man. I'm telling you, when I feel very tired with all these debates, and I get up in the morning and aaj chodo, aaj chutti lete hain, and I put on the TV and I see my prime minister running from one program to another, delivering something or other, then I feel this man is working so hard, I, as a young man, I should follow him. So he has, in fact, brought a new energy to Indian polity. Let me tell you, before this, well, Indira Gandhi, despite the fact that she was in opposition, she wasn't in opposition to us, but still we respect her because she had that kind of aura and energy with her. After Indira Gandhi, I see Mr. Modi as a person who has that kind of energy which the youth, in fact, look upon for. I'm sorry to state that the opposition does not have a leader of that stature, and that's the reason. But natural that they would find fault in the campaigner rather than learning from him. And secondly, and very importantly, as far as the Prime Minister, Mr. Modi, is concerned, see, he has his focus and his priorities right, straight for India. India pehle, baad mein party. That is how he functions. For him,
a bit like Trump from
but he talks like of Congress Mukt Bharat, so no, I don't know what India pehle and party was.
Let's not go into rhetorics. Look,
no, that's his rhetoric, not mine.
I'll tell you one thing, where we get him wrong. It was only other day, somewhere nearby, we were in a coffee shop. I was with some leading journalists of the country, and we were watching the television speech of Mr. Modi. In fact, he was delivering a speech in Uttar Pradesh, and he was speaking about Ujjala Yojana, and he said that ये जो धुआं आता है 20 सिगरेट के बराबर माताएं धुआं पी लेती हैं और हमको ये ठीक करना है. एंड देन वन जर्नलिस्ट सेड दैट अरे यार ये हर दिन यही बोलते हैं. देन यू लुक, आई विल टेल यू वेयर वी आर लूजिंग द प्लॉट. द प्लॉट इज दैट वी डू नॉट रियलाइज स्टिल देयर आर वुमेन हु आर कुकिंग विद fire stoves, who are cooking with fire woods and all that. We feel that hum Delhi mein hai, everyone is like Delhi. And that he realizes, no, it is not Latians Delhi. There are people who really need to be uplifted. They have to be pulled up. And that's why he repeats this, that look, ye mai bahut important hai. And that's where we have lost the plot. You know, the media, don't mind my words, but media also felt ye important nahi hai. And the opposition also felt that these mothers were not important. And we got our vote because of these mothers, because Modi had the connect with the real India. We were losing that plot somewhere.
I'll come to something that he said earlier when he says that it's not just Modi who's to blame, it's also the opposition. You know, we are missing an opposition, aren't we?
Well, there's no doubt that there is no single voice in the opposition. Mm-hmm. If you take the panoply of parties, there isn't a single voice who has either the credibility or the continuity or even the risk-taking ability of the Prime Minister. And talking of gatekeepers, I think that the Prime Minister, and then thereby followed nobly by Trump, has chosen to avoid traditional gatekeepers and go onto Twitter, and their own rhetoric comes out loud and clear. You know, if one looks at comparisons, and this is why the opposition's inability to articulate itself is actually shocking. It's amazing that some of them are actually still speaking. Is that you need to have loud voices on both sides if this is not to become a kind of echo chamber. Hmm. The danger today is in that this excess of communications, which is going unanswered in some senses, results in an echo chamber, and the public happily and willingly goes along because there is no other voice they are hearing. The moment that happens and there is a dialectic, then I hope things will change.
Okay, we are hoping for a change. There are 2 more years of Prime Minister Modi. Well, according to him, he's got, I think, 10 more years. He's looking at 2022. But that's it from us. We'll see you again same time next week.